is that states have a positive obligation. Well, they have an obligation not to carry out improper surveillance to start with. They also have a positive obligation to prevent other states from spying on their citizens. And of course, they shouldn't collude in illegal surveillance by third states either. And also to add to what Professor Scheinin has also said, it is modern international law generally that states should comply with their international human rights requirements also when they're acting in relation to people outside their territory. And that has been very well established by the court. The court has said very clearly, states should not be allowed to do things on the territory of other state parties that they are not allowed to do at home. That makes good common sense, and I think it's something to remember. There are also very clear procedural requirements in the European Convention on Human Rights. There must be very strict control of surveillance. There must be strict time limits. There must be strict purpose limitation spelled out in the law. And all that is not in existence in the systems that we have seen in the United Kingdom. And I hope everybody here is aware of the general data protection principles, and I don't have to spell them out. Processing of data has to be fair, it has to be transparent, it has to serve a lawful purpose, it has to have a proper legal basis, there must be restrictions on transported data flows, people must be given rights. We all know those principles. All I can say is the kind of surveillance that we now know has taken place from the United Kingdom in particular, but it looks like there are other European states that have not behaved well either, is utterly incompatible with the most fundamental data protection principles in Europe. Absolutely, utterly, fundamentally in conflict with the most basic European human rights and data protection principles. Next slide. With reference, by the way, to an interesting study on the views of the different national courts on data retention. And I think it's important to look at that. If data retention is dubious, and I find it extremely dubious, then mass surveillance and data mining is beyond the pale. Finally, on that data protection issue, something, this is, I'm afraid, a hobby horse of mine, but when you do data mining on the basis of keyword searches, be it artificial intelligence being used to make computers learn to come up with more and more sophisticated outcomes of those searches, you're effectively instituting profiling. Profiles, I've written it in other contexts, are dangerous, inherently dangerous by themselves, especially if you're looking for very rare phenomena like terrorists, let alone potential terrorists, or people who may become terrorists. You're inevitably going to end up with massive amounts of false negatives and false positives that are going to destroy the lives of many people. It is something that really should be cautioned against in the context of the general data protection regulation, but also in this particular context of data mining for national security purposes. I've given an example here from the Schleswig-Holstein law on national security monitoring, just to show one example of how you can have laws that are restrictive and that are certainly on the face of it, human rights compliant. And what you can see here is very clear, a clear definition of the purpose, what can be, or for what purposes surveillance can be used. And I'll come back to that in a minute when I talk about the national security exemption. A clear requirement that activities must be targeted, and I think Jan Albrecht again asked a question about that. There have to be specific evidence for specific targets. The final point, it has to be based on real, factual, individualized evidence. Suspicion evidence. It doesn't, of course, have to be sufficient to convict, but sufficient evidence to target individuals rather than broad sweeping surveillance of everybody just in case somebody might possibly in the future become a terrorist or become some kind of subversive in some other way. That is the opposite of the rule of law. If states act outside their territory, that also violates the sovereignty of those other territories. And that's a principle that goes back hundreds of years, most clearly stated in the Lotus case by the Permanent Court for International Justice in 1927. And I think I've got the quote here. I haven't got the actual quote, but it's the first and most holy principle of international law is that you do not exercise your power on the territory of, or dare I say it, with regard to the citizens of another state. So states also acting in violation of general principles of public international law, and Vivian Redding, by the way, confirmed that as well. In that context, one particular issue, there is a proposal in Strasbourg that a new additional protocol be added to the Cybercrime Convention that would legalize this cross-border gathering of evidence by law enforcement and possibly also national security agencies. Peter Hustings has said before this very committee, everything must be done to stop that additional protocol, and I totally and fully endorse him in that view. That the United States in particular, under FISA, has an extremely broad definition of what the NSA can do. It's not limited to national security, as anybody can reasonably understand it. They can hoover up any data that might in any way be useful or relevant or of interest in relation to the United States international relations. It can include commercial spying. It can include political spying on totally non-violent political groups, such as Big Brother Watch or ORG or any of the other groups that I work with, but also environmental groups or gay rights groups or anything they fancy. The United Kingdom's definition is also deficient. In fact, there is no definition of national security in UK law. The courts have refused to entertain it all. They said it's much broader than it used to be. It used to be a threat to the independence and the existence of the state. But now it can also include pandemics, environmental threats, and there has even been a case in which the United Kingdom refused to continue a case, a very serious bribery case in the UK courts, because it threatened the good relations with the country where the bribery took place, and it said that too, having good relations with bad countries, is also part of national security. So the concept of national security in UK law is much too wide. In the UN instruments, I want to mention the Johannesburg principles, which were drafted by Article 19, but they have been endorsed by a range of political bodies, I think including at the Council of Europe and at the UN. And it has a very restrictive definition, as you can see here, of national security. It is to protect the country's existence or its territorial integrity against the use or threat of force, or its capacity to respond to the threat or use of force. It is not legitimate to use national security powers to protect the government from embarrassment or exposure of wrongdoing, or to conceal information about the functioning of its institutions, and I might add, or to get some advantage in diplomatic negotiations or to give advantage to companies from that country. It is concerned that this committee and the EU generally has the competence to check whether the USA is acting in contravention of the EU's data protection rules in any activity carried out in the EU, and we know that EU data protection rules have applied to non-EU-based controllers in certain respects, and of course, especially with regard to the safe harbour and the PNR and SWIFT agreements, I can say, I believe anybody can say, and certainly anybody who heard Connolly's presentation to this committee, the safe harbour is the most unsafe harbour you could possibly wish to steer your ship into. I think I will leave it at this. I hope I've more or less kept my time. I just want to say at the end, I agree with Peter Hustings, my compatriot, that we are facing an existential challenge to our fundamental rights and liberty. This is not some kind of trivial issue. We are talking about in an interconnected age of something that touches the very core, Professor Scheidin said it as well, the very core of our right of autonomy in a free and democratic society. Thank you.